What's up, everybody? It's Joe La Puma. You are listening. You are watching the Complex Sneakers podcast. As always, I'm with my guys. First off, to my right, Mr. Matt Welty.
We're here.
Okay. You got four. You took a power nap, 4 minutes, you said?
Dude, isn't it crazy how, like, you can be sleep deprived of, like, 2 to 3, 4 hours, but you fall asleep for, like, 4 to 5 minutes and somehow, like,
he's back.
Negates all of it?
Yeah. He's back. I love that. The Undertaker gif.
Remember? I remember
it. To my left, Mr. Brendan Dunne. He got the toes out. Jasmine, shouts to Jasmine, by the way.
Our producer, mentioned that I going sockless today.
She pointed out that you got the toes out, and special shout out to Jasmine. Onward and upward.
Yeah.
So, shouts to her. Thanks for all the help.
Absolutely.
How we doing? I'm back in the studio. If you guys haven't noticed by now, we're back.
we're here. Good banter already.
You took your talents to South Beach.
So. Yeah. South Beach with Mr. Pogba.
That used to be like I feel like back in the day, like 2016, to be like JLP just like scooting out to South Beach, like
what
you taking like IG photos with like the fly knit trainers and the Rolly, like on the.
I like how we went from what?
So that yep, no, I know exactly. I know exactly what he's talking about. It was
talk about it then.
It was in front of a pool. We'll put the picture. It wasn't. It was like Hollywood, Florida, or Fort Lauderdale.
Okay.
It was actually when I was doing the Wale shoot.
Okay.
And that night, I hung out with John Geiger. We went out the night before. One of the only times I've ever went out before a shoot was with John Geiger. We went out, and I had the Wale shoot.
You were at Live?
Wasn't at Live. It was, I forget what club it was. I remember we got late night pizza, though, like 4 a.m. pizza. And you know me, I would never go out before a shoot, but Geiger. And then I remember, I don't know if it was at his apartment, but Geiger put me on to a classic show because before we went out, we were at an apartment and Pawn Stars was on.
Oh,
classic.
Yeah. So
and
he
that
was like,
the first time you'd seen it?
That was like the first
and
time
you,
I saw it.
And then you ended up getting
Chumlee.
You had Chumlee.
I've never seen it.
But the good thing about, oh, no, you were saying.
Yeah, but that, I know exactly what
you
photo.
Have, I think you
Jonathan
had,
Lees took that photo.
I think you
way.
Had like the, it must have been the, you were big on the multicolored Flyknit trainers.
Yep.
We all were. You know,
I wonder, I hope that that's the same photo, but I know exactly what photo.
That was,
even if I wasn't wearing those in that photo, they were definitely on the trip and I know exactly what he's talking about.
I was like, the good thing about like going out with Geiger to a club is that, you know, when you, you're in like a packed area and all of a sudden you like lose your friend for 2 seconds and you're like, oh crap, like how am I gonna
big
find
guy.
This person? You can see Geiger from across the room.
Big guy. Also, it's his birthday week, so happy birthday.
Happy birthday, John.
How are we doing?
I feel good. I just got back to New York as well. I was in LA over the weekend.
Yeah, you were. Oh, wait a minute. How did that go?
Yeah, it was a good time.
How was the assignment?
Yeah, it was good.
Did you understand it?
Yeah.
You understood the assignment. It was good?
Yeah. It was a good time.
Oh, man, we didn't even talk about that.
We can't even leak any sort of information.
No, we're not going to leak any information.
It's nothing that crazy.
Okay, but let's talk about it after, and
we'll
keep you guys in the loop. But I
went out there and shot some sneakers from a movie.
Yeah.
A big prop.
Yeah,
I was gonna like mumble the first four bars of the theme song, but
all right.
I don't even know what they would be.
No.
Okay, exactly. It was a good time. I was actually with Jacques Slade on his birthday.
Another
very
birthday.
Serendipitous.
Happy
birthday to Jacques.
Yeah, happy
any
birthday,
other
Jacques.
Any other industry birthdays? We got Geiger, Jacques.
Oh, today's my dad's birthday.
Is he in the industry?
No,
his son is. Happy birthday, Mr. Welty.
Yes,
we hope
happy
you have
birthday,
your
Mike.
Freshest 990s on.
993s, 993s, or the New Balance 623s,
okay.
the white navies.
Yes, sir.
You're gonna recreate the Kith family thing for this week.
Wow.
Might as
well.
For his birthday.
Yeah,
could be big.
We could be doing it.
Okay.
Yeah, I spent some time with Jacques. You know who else I connected with? Our dear friend Justin Bolas. And it's always stressful.
Oh,
so the
God.
People who don't know, Justin Bolas works on the First We Feast team here at Complex, which means that anytime you go anywhere, he is double-checking all the places you went to eat and giving you feedback on whether or not you ate at the right places. But I was with him, so he couldn't give me any complaints.
Is it fun or stressful eating food with Justin Bolas?
He's being nice because he said giving feedback. He's judging.
It's always negative feedback.
He's judging. I've said it on this podcast before. He has a bunch of shows on First We Feast and
burger
being
show.
In LA, the burger show, the
tacos con todo.
Yes. And, you know, sometimes he'll be on set or I'll see him in LA and I'll just be like, what'd you do last night? Oh, I went to, you know, had a good dinner, went here. And I will say the place and he'll just
Scowl.
Yeah, scowl. So it's stressful. That's
but we
good
had
though.
An incredible burrito. Okay. Chilriano burrito, and I was really happy about that. So
nice.
Yeah.
Feel a lot lighter.
Yeah, what happened? I heard you liquidated?
Yeah. Purged about 40 pairs this weekend.
Wow.
It felt great.
That's a great feeling. What'd you do with them?
Just put them out like on the sidewalk.
Donation.
Take me?
Street donation.
Yeah, street donation. Just like there's like an electrical box or whatever like on the corner of my street, and I would just like put them out there like overnight and they'd be gone or whatever. Yeah. But
what is what's the significance of the electrical box?
Just a place to like rest, like put it on top so it's not just like sitting on the sidewalk.
Yeah.
Okay. But you follow all protocol? You like, you know, you can't just throw stuff on the
yeah,
sidewalk.
You being the super.
Exactly. That's
no, that's like what I do. I would just take like two or three pairs at a time. I didn't want to put like 20 pairs of shoes out on the sidewalk.
Block the electrical box.
And just leave it there. Or like I didn't put, the most annoying part about it was that I would take the shoes, but I would not put the boxes out because for some reason in my head, I would think that people would take the shoes and discard the box.
Yeah, and
for whatever reason,
you can't have a bunch of cardboard.
You want a bunch of cardboard boxes laying in the street. Yeah. But it was good to like have that like to be like detached from certain things because you always think about you're like I have all these shoes, but I'm a sneaker collector. I'm not a hoarder. But then when you're like I can't get rid of a sneaker from like 2014 that I wore five times that, you know what, I'm probably never going to wear these again, you know, like, and it's good to just be able to be like, hey, you know what? You're never wearing this again.
That's growth right there.
Just move on from it. Or you may even find stuff from like 4 years ago where you're like, oh dude, I never wore these. And you know what? I'm probably not going to. Yeah. So like, I'd much rather someone else have it. But the good thing in the process is through getting rid of all those shoes and feeling like you have like much more space in your apartment. Also found a lot of stuff that you forgot that
sneakers.
Yes, that you have.
Give us one.
It was just a bunch of like New Balance like 990s that I'm like, oh, I forgot I had those because I always kind of like rifle through the same shoes. Yeah. And then when you have such like a cluttered shoe situation, it's harder to like dig through all the boxes and find everything. But you know, got rid of a lot of stuff and found some more stuff, so it was like a win-win situation.
Nice.
I'm glad to hear that. Another thing I wanted to mention before we forget, in terms of, we talked about some birthdays earlier and big personal milestones for people in and around the industry. Our friend Ian Stonebrook got married this past
weekend. I saw that. Mm-hmm. Congrats to him.
Yeah, Ian Stonebrook's been around writing about sneakers for a long time. He's currently in Boardroom. Did any of us get the invite to the wedding?
Did not get the invite.
Same.
I'm
devastated.
Did not get the invite. The closest I came to the invite was I replied to a wedding IG story with the clapping thing. And
you're a bigger man than me.
Wow.
No, I'm kidding.
No,
I'm kidding. Congratulations to you.
Yeah. So wait, didn't get the invite.
No.
Not even the person at like the church who hands out the pamphlets. in the beginning. Not even like
I would have been happy to help. I would have, you know.
Where was it?
Probably Texas, right?
Oh.
I think he is based in Texas.
Maybe he knew you were in L.A.
Yeah, maybe. No, I'm not going to hold it against
him. Yeah, of course. Shouts to Ian. Great, great, young. Still young, I'm sure. Because he's been writing about sneakers for a while. Great young talent.
A sweet man. Yeah. A kind-hearted
great guy.
Gentleman.
Great vintage jersey collection, too.
Yeah. Other sneaker things? How about Adidas suing Nike?
Another
this seems
lawsuit,
so
guys.
Misguided to me. I don't understand this one at all. I always get hyped about lawsuits, but this one, I'm like, why
is this? Is this the one lawsuit that you don't care about?
Why? I mean, I care about it because Adidas suing Nike is a big deal, but they're claiming Nike's infringing on all this stuff that Adidas made years ago. They're saying the sneakers app is infringing upon the Adidas confirmed app and this Adidas, you know, customizable fit shoe from years ago is
it's like technology that's
inspired,
like longer being used. Or in all honesty, a lot of those Adidas products that they were referencing within the, and I know this doesn't really have the biggest precedent probably on like on litigation or whatever, but it was stuff that like failed at market that like Adidas seemed pretty much like they abandoned altogether, but now they're suing over it, you know?
Yeah, you know, usually when these lawsuits pop up, there's some instigating event that's very easy to point to or you know, straw on a camel's back somewhere. But this, I don't understand it.
I think the one that actually made sense, and this was the more recent like analogy to this, is when there was that whole lawsuit where Adidas had sued Nike over like the Prime Knit
Yeah, there was a legal battle over
versus Flyknit Tech.
Yeah.
But that made sense.
Yeah, that was stuff was new at the time.
But it was also like they're very clearly kind of making the same tech, and it's like, how did this happen? You know?
Yeah, I mean, the Nike sneakers app, like, really? I don't get it. I don't get it.
He says that now, but he'll be digging in just like this through the documents, just like this. Okay.
Oh, what else is happening?
With the highlighter out.
Tom Sachs, Nike's dropped. Anybody get them?
Didn't get them.
Are you into them now?
I'm not. They're just not my style, but I do think that they're gonna because they're.
Wait,
going
were you accusing him of flip flopping?
He always does. He always does. He always keeps saying even. Yeah,
what's a shoe? Think, what's a shoe that
I flip flop?
Yeah, you would think that you first you didn't really like it, but it grew on you.
Oh man, let me think. I'd have to think. There's a lot though. Mm-hmm. There's a lot.
Do you have one, Brendan?
Do you have one?
I'm not sure off the top, but do you?
I mean, those Tom Sachs ones are growing on me, but I don't. There's.
Well, no, I mean, you are no, the Tom Sachs guy, so
I do like that. They're gonna constantly
restock.
Yeah, that's
perennial
cool.
Release. Yeah,
it's almost like the
them.
Supreme Air Force Ones.
I think so. Similar type of thing. Make
that's
them plenty
nice.
Available. Yeah, sure. I was trying to get a pair for a friend, but.
What about the Martin Rose Nike Shox?
I appreciate that. I would never wear that shoe, but it's funny because it's in the same vein as the last Martin Rose of taking, you know, they did the Monarchs last
the
time.
The most like, uncool
shoe. You know, yeah, just a weird shoe, weird uncool shoe.
I
yeah,
but like those, that shoe.
What?
Was it, the R4?
The Shox?
Yeah.
Well, God bless you then.
Wait, isn't it the Shox R4?
Yeah.
I know you hate Shox.
You gonna do the Martine Rose version of the Shox?
I don't think so, just because I have big feet and
they look like
the Shox R4.
They look like cowboy boots.
Yeah, you should pull those out, Joe.
I've worn the Shox R4.
Wait, you should pull out the Martine Rose ones.
The Martine Rose, the black and red ones.
I don't know about those, just because the
extra 6 inches on the front there.
Yeah.
on the footwear, I mean.
I've worn Shox R4s as like recent as like. 3 years ago, I think. Yeah, all black in these. I have. They re-released.
Oh, okay. I didn't.
Are you guys shooting this week?
Nope.
No.
Ugh. Busy week for busy couple shoots.
There's also the, week. How do you, sorry if I mispronounce it, the Jacqumes.
Yep, Jacqumes, Nike collaboration. Doesn't do much for me.
Terra Humara.
Yeah, those look bad.
Okay. That was in the Slack today. I think I might have missed
it. Not a JLP
it.
Shoe either?
No, I don't think so.
Not the brown ones?
I'm still waiting on the CDG Sunders.
We keep getting tagged in that.
That and was
people tag me on that stuff all the time. By the way, that's okay with me, but please stop tagging me in the meme about On God and Busted and thing. Like, I know I look, you know.
I got that.
Yeah.
Which one is it?
It's the meme where they have kind of the TikTok haircut that looks quite like mine, where it's someone with a kind of a curly little situation on top, Lucille Ball hairdo, and then maybe a fade on the sides, and it's, you know, On God, these things are busted. And
oh, I didn't.
Well, your mentions don't look like mine then. But never, yeah, never stop tagging me in the one of the guy who looks like Welty and or producer Dave Matthews on the Heelys. That I will always take.
That one's just funny, though, because me and Dave don't look alike.
No.
Right, but that guy looks like the exact average of you two.
That's true.
It's like, how does this work with the either of us look alike, but somehow this guy supposedly looks like either one of us?
Yep. Straight down the middle. Should we give some shoes away?
Yeah, 13 minutes in. That one, like that.
Okay. We got some sneakers to give away, courtesy of the good people at eBay, as we do every week through their eBay Authenticity Guarantee Program. Here's how it works. If you go to eBay.complex.com, you can submit a question for us. If we pick your question, if we answer your question here on the air, we are going to send you a free pair of sneakers with the eBay authenticity tag attached, so you know it's real. What are we giving away this week? Welty?
Yep.
Something behind your desk there?
Yep.
Ooh.
Something you want to pull out for the people?
What a surprise, another New Balance shoe.
For one person specifically?
He's on brand.
What are we giving away?
The...
Okay, a little too many J's, but
never
we'll
gets old.
We'll
never gets old.
Okay. Okay.
Never gets old.
These are nice. Jow 992s.
Jow 992s. And they're going to.
And I like this one more than the green.
Okay.
Just saying.
I'm with you on that.
They are going to Alex Arias. Excuse my if I mispronounce. Alex Arias of Clemson, South Carolina asks, how do you feel about companies who create general release shoes that look eerily similar to collaboration pairs? Then he puts in parentheses, easy slide, very topical, Bacon Air Max.
That I think that one's a false.
Yeah, I don't know about the Bacon Air Max.
They just didn't. They retro the shoe and just didn't have the. They just didn't label it as a
off whites, etc.
Yeah, I wasn't sure what they meant by that.
But he does have a point because this has happened a lot throughout sneaker history.
But, I mean, and it's newly relevant because Kanye West just this week. Yes. Put out this Instagram post blasting Adidas and CEO Casper Rohr said, along with a guy called DC, who I believe is named Daniel Cherry III, saying, Adidas, you have to stop ripping off my stuff. He posted an image of the new Adilette 22 slide saying, basically, this looks quite like the Adidas Yeezy
Those
slide.
Those have been going around quite a bit lately, too. Not just because Yeezy related, but people. Were just, I think people were just excited on that design in general.
Topographical thing. I mean, I think Kanye West has every right to complain here. It's kind of weird that he's bringing this up now because it feels like this is something that Adidas has been doing for years and has done much more fragrantly
in
the past.
I would say since the inception of Yeezy.
Yeah, some of but those even shoes, the Tubular Invader, the Tubular Shadow Knit, if you go and look at these shoes, they look like the, what is it, we have Yeezys at home, you know, the meme like that.
Well, the real thing was is, you know, 2015, 2016, whatever, that was like the classic sort of like Kais Omar, like YouTube clickbait of like, we found Yeezys at the outlet.
Oh, and it's like the Yeezy looking shoe.
Or it was like Yeezy sitting at Champs and it would be like, oh, look at it. Obviously it was a joke, but it would be like one of those like tubular shoes.
You say Kais Omar, I say January 5th, 2016, Soul Collector headline, Nike trolls Kanye West with Yeezy lookalike.
Oh, the Enter deck, Trainer?
The deck, no chill, bye. Hold on. Yeah. Nike's not doing retro Air Yeezys anytime soon, but it's damn sure going to water down Kanye West's aesthetic and keep selling it to sneakerheads. Bye, Brendan Dunne. Nike
I'm on
Air,
record
Nike,
for, yep, for
Nike
years
Air
now.
Enter Trainer.
That one was flagrant. That one was wild.
But I'm not saying that Kanye doesn't have the right to be mad about it, but I feel like this also occurred while he was at Nike the whole time, where there was a bunch of like Yeezy.
Yeah.
Look-alike shoes
and colorways, because the rose ones, I got two pair of those.
Yeah, there was always that. But also since, like, I would say the dawn of sneaker time, there's always been like takedown versions of like Nike basketball shoes, or like the 574 is a takedown of the 576. Mm-hmm. You know, where it's like they'll take this shoe and then like make like the Kohl's version of it. Yeah. You know, that
this or the GR. Correct me if I'm wrong, but a lot of times they use collabs or high energy product to sell through a kind of like a silo. It's a little different than what he's talking about, ripping off the slides, and then they'll come with like the GR version, because
or
like
or
just like the New Balance 550.
Yeah.
Or you said like last week where we talked about like the Ace 83, you know? Yeah. But I mean, Adidas has been doing it for a while. Like you talked about that. I don't want to like name any specific shoes, but like there was definitely like Adidas designers who told me like, oh yeah, we created the shoe, and they like made me like make the shoe on the last of the 350.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, wow. But it was like,
okay, that's like real.
Yeah. But at
very
the time,
deliberate.
I think at the time too, there was kind of like, and I think Adidas was pretty like open about it. Like this is like 2016 or whatever, where they were like, the whole point is to have a brand synergy.
Right.
So if Yeezy was, or Yeezy, it's hard to just pinpoint Yeezy, I feel like, at that time, because NMD and like Ultra Boost were all within the same vein, and it's not like
similar
the,
language design.
And it's
wise.
Not like the Yeezy informed all those shoes. It was like they just all kind of happened to coincide at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And also the NMD was designed by the same person who designed the 350.
Yeah.
Nick Galloway.
Also, an interesting thing about the 350 is Kanye has been transparent about that being a version of the Roshi Rhyme.
But you saw at the time where it was like that language kind of spread all throughout the brand, where it was even like the first James Harden shoe kind of looked like Yeezy-esque.
The other thing I would say, like, that probably is getting annoying to him, besides this Adidas slide that looks similar to the Yeezy slide, these isn't like Walmart selling these are
the fake
Yeezy slides are all over.
Like the Alibaba like Yeezy slides,
they're
or whatever.
All over, and they're like in droves. Yeah. Like you just go, you'll just see a kiosk with tons of different colors.
It's almost like you can't even tell, because it's such like a simple product. Like from afar, can you really tell if it's a Yeezy slide or not? You know?
Yeah, I will say, I do think Kanye is totally justified in being upset at this. And I agree that it's been happening in the sneaker industry for a long time, but that doesn't mean it can't change. And I think Kanye West has done a lot to change the industry.
I'm not saying like you have the right to like steal ideas, but if you're working for a brand and there's like a certain design feel associated with certain product in the brand, like why are they not allowed to kind of like work off of that?
I don't know. It just doesn't feel right to take the idea without getting consent from the person who's most responsible for the idea.
So much.
Yeah. Also, to me, it's funny this is coming up because to me that Adidas Adilet slide, the topographical map looking one, there's a shoe that I thought looked more like it, which is from this brand Zellerfeld, who makes 3D printed shoes.
Oh,
it's supposed
yeah,
to look kind of 3D printed. And there's this Kid Super version of a Zellerfeld shoe that has that same topographical look. To me, I was thinking months ago that these looked like those.
Well,
but
the one that I think people pointing to on like Twitter, Instagram, whatever that I had seen was, I guess Adidas had actually made like something to what you're wearing, like a foam runner.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's also an upcoming foam runner looking shoe where that is, again,
but it
a
has
way
like,
more blatant ripoff.
It's a foam runner, but it has like a sock in it to some degree.
Oh, there's like an inner booty on the shoe?
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's like, it's a little higher than that. It's not like a straight up slip on. I guess like a good question would be like, what's the difference between a Yeezy 350 in like a, like you said, like a tubular invader, right? Or whatever the name of the shoe was, that look alike, and a Air Jordan 4 and a Jordan Flight 89.
That, yeah.
I mean, the difference is Michael Jordan owns Jordan brand.
No, but I meant at the time though.
I don't know if I understand the How analogy. Is
the Flight 89 to Jordan 4? It's the same shoe, but it, one of them's the Nike like takedown version and one of them's the Air Jordan premium version.
Yeah.
I'm assuming that a lot of people probably bought that Flight 89 at the time because like they couldn't get the Air Jordan.
That's the question. Was it as popping crazy and then they did it? There's some sort of context, like if the shoe, the one that comes before is going crazy and then they do it versus if the one that it was kind of based off wasn't a hit.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
All right.
So I guess that answers the question.
Listen, we got some minutes of discussion off that question. That's why he's getting the Joun New Balances. Alex.
Nice shoes.
All right. Let's bring on our guest for the week.
Let's do it. Our guest on today's podcast has been responsible for the many bespoke haircuts you've seen Kanye West don throughout the years. Growing up in Chicago, he quickly became the go-to when local style movers needed to stand out from the pack. Being part of the West Collective for decades allowed him to keep progressing as a creative who became obsessed with all things product, sneakers, clothing, jewelry, and even skateboards. Although he's still a mainstay on cover shoots for your favorite artists like Kanye and Kid Cudi, it's been how he's came into his own through design on brands like his own line, Cordova, collaborating on sneaker design with Diamond, and more recently with Converse on the One Star. So much history to get into today. We wanted to welcome to the Complex Sneakers Podcast, Ibn Jasper. Thanks so much for doing this. Feel like it's been a long time coming.
Yes.
But perfect timing now, especially with the Converse we'll get to.
Ivan, before we get into this, we want to talk about the shoes we have on feet. So can you tell us what you're wearing?
I am wearing my friends and family colorway of my One Star. But this is a sample. I didn't even get a production pair because they ran out.
Damn.
Which I guess is a good
problem. The rarest of the rare.
I guess it's a good problem.
Yeah. Yeah. Welty, what do you have on feet?
Have on, shout out our good friend June Sanders. Downtown Locker Room, New Balance 997, Greek Gods.
Nice.
CDG 180s for me. Keep going back to these. Whenever there's like a big shoot, you know, I think I wore these for the PJ Tucker sneaker shopping. We have a great guest today. I go back to the CDG 180s. They're a little dirty, but...
Got some miles on them.
Yeah, I'm comfortable.
You know, nice. That's like the little...
You know?
Yeezy 180.
Yeah, exactly. Right? Full circle moment.
Yeezy.
Yeah, I'm doing the Yeezy foam runners. I mean, I love this shoe. Yeah. I'm no socks. Do you wear these with socks or no socks?
I don't have a pair of those.
Okay. I like to go no
but
socks.
But I do like seeing them. Now, it would be a great beach shoe.
Yes. Yep. Yeah, you hit the beach in these.
And Matt George had on a pair one day with like some Arc'teryx. Like ski pants.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, that looks fresh.
I like to do no socks. They're chewing up my feet a little bit, so I am band-aided up right now, but
Okay.
I feel like your feet sweat a little bit in those, you know?
Don't 80 worry degrees about. In New York City, you're just pounding the pavement in those? People
don't want to hear too much about my sweaty feet on this podcast.
Going to be a long walk home?
We'll cut it there.
With the subway fumes creeping into the right. holes.
But yeah, early sneaker history we want to talk about a little bit. Was it like back in the day, like the Cortez was the one that you like got hooked on? What was it? You were always into sneakers, I know.
Yeah, I think it was a court classic.
Okay.
A Nike, like the tennis classic or whatever yeah. that mm-hmm. is. It was either that or a Cortez. It was white leather with a red stripe. And it had the off-white, like, security tag on yep. it yep. On the shelf. That was it. And then sneakers that I really remember was my father got out of jail on parole when I was, like, 9. Mm-hmm. And came and picked me up and took me and bought some bread Sky Jordans.
Not even the Air Jordan.
Because kids yeah. yep, were Sky Jordans. Yep. Mm-hmm. So he had. So I had the first ones. And he took me and got some Perrier.
Okay.
And we went downtown Chicago.
Where'd you go in Chicago? Like, I need to know what happened the rest all right, of the
so,
day.
So, yeah. Okay, so.
Got some beautiful memory.
This is like when I look back at it, I'm like, oh, man, my father really, like, prepared me for what I'm doing now, right? Yeah. So he got me some Sky Jordan breads, took me to drink some Perrier, French water. Mm-hmm. You guys know how we do in Paris,
yep,
right?
Yep, yep.
And then he took me to Staten Lake. And Staten Lake, downtown Chicago, was when I was skating when I was a kid, that was like Love Park.
Okay.
Right? So before I even started skating, that's where I had mm-hmm. Jordans and French water.
Got it.
Yeah.
So I thought you were going to say he went to go take you to go get a haircut, and that would have been like the full circle. Like.
Did he not?
I actually feel embarrassed because I feel like I need a haircut so bad right now. And we have Ivan who's
no, but you camouflaging something, so it's all good.
That's true. The other thing, talk about like Chicago back then. You know, we'll get to the crew, but like the epicenter coming up. Back then, you know, you talk about basically your dad was like forward on product and sneakers and things like that. Talk about that time and like in the city, what it was like.
Okay. So at that time, Don brought out something that's very important to that era, mm-hmm. which is the Buck 50 hat.
Mm.
Right. So it's like the ball cap with the snakeskin brim, yep. A watch. You know what I'm saying? Like, take the bands off a watch and put the watch on your hat with mm-hmm. wings.
Yeah.
And then you got, like, the leather, the snakeskin strap in the back. So it's just like, you know, Chicago, Midwest, it's like pimps, players, and hustlers. So you yeah. got, like, Don Magic Wand, like, the documentary Pimps Up, Hoes Down. Like, that's what it's really about. So we got.
I've actually never seen it. I remember being a kid and seeing that at the movie store all the time and being like, I wonder if I'll ever be able to watch that.
Yeah. But that's really where our fashion thing comes mm-hmm. from, because the pimps and everything is getting the suits made and getting their cars done up and getting the jewelry and everything, right? So that's really why we took to Paris like that, because it's like we got Barbara Bates, MD Fashion, we got all these like tailor shops and suit makers and stuff like that, that you know, Steve Harvey suits, like mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. all that type of stuff. That's the culture we come from, but we did it the hip hop way. We did it the like Eric B and Rakim, Dapper Dan way.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
And you talk about the Buck 50 hats and everything that like a lot of things that you guys were making and like the Don C, no one really, everyone saw it and was like, oh, this is such an expensive hat. But then when you hear the story behind it, where it was like 80 Chicago street guys and you kind of started coming up with cutting hair with street guys as well, right?
Absolutely.
And that's where you guys were like getting fashion tips yeah, from.
It's all about getting money. Mm. Mm-hmm. Like that's what I don't get about all of this, like, make it cheaper. It's like, no, you're supposed to look at it like, okay, one day I'm going to have a Benz. Mm. One day I'm going to have a Rolly.
It's aspirational.
One day I'm going to, you know, like I'm taking this step and this step and this step so I can get what I want. I was just talking to John Monopoly the other day. And I was, he was like, yeah, we doing this and that. And I was like, bro, we doing the same thing at this super high level. We doing the same thing we was doing in high school.
Mm.
In our generation, like the kids born in the 70s and 80s, we invented the lifetime childhood.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because in somebody in like 1985, if somebody was 30, they looked like they were 50.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And I'm about to be 50. And really? I don't, yeah, I'm 47.
Wow.
And I don't look nowhere like that.
No, you don't. Nothing
like
you don't.
You know, you mentioned skateboarding being a big part of your life growing up and everything. And you know, you mentioned Jordans and people skating in them. But what were your thoughts like early on when you would see shoes like a, you know, like a Costin 1 or like the Stevie Williams shoe, where it was very clear that like skateboarding and sneakers were like becoming like one thing? Did that kind of like inspire you to some extent?
Absolutely. Like Stevie is like, he's like one of my biggest heroes. Mm. And I just always looked at, like I looked at Michael Jordan and Tony Hawk as like the same. Mm. You know what I'm saying?
So, even being from Chicago?
Well, I'm 10 years old. I'm 11 years old.
Yeah.
So I'm like, he's flying through the air and he's flying through the air.
Like yeah. that.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And actually Tony Hawk is flying higher than Michael Jordan.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like what Tony's doing is way more dangerous than what Mike's doing.
Sure, sure, sure.
You know what I'm saying? And that's how I look at it. Like what's more dangerous is who's better, who has the better skill.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So like Jordan can never do what Tony Hawk does.
Yeah.
But Tony can hoop.
You think?
I mean, anybody. Pretty much anybody can shoot a basketball.
Oh, I thought you were gonna have a story of playing basketball with Tony Hawk, and that was gonna be amazing.
No.
You had to think about it.
And I'm not downplaying basketball or anything like that, but you know, like what we do, like extreme athletes, like what we do, you can die.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You're very literally just putting your life on the line.
Yeah. Every time.
Have you met Tony?
Yeah, I know Tony.
How did that happen?
When the
video game first came out or before that?
Nah, like probably maybe 7-8 years ago or something like that. It's funny, I just seen him at the Dior show and I walked up to him. He was like, "Oh man, my son was saying somebody was over there, I couldn't hear him, and it was you." But it was good seeing him like all Dior down. I was like, "What up, Street Hawk?"
Yeah.
Do you remember, kind of going back to those early sneaker memories, but when y'all were in the industry, you know, the first times you got to go out to Nike campus and meeting Mark Smith, meeting Tinker Hatfield, like what were those trips like?
I don't think I actually met them, but they were like, it was kind of like the kitchen was probably about like this big.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
And it was like Tinker was like over there, Mark was like right there.
Yeah.
And they're just showing us stuff, and they're showing us like all their like quick prototyping stuff, like, oh, we can make a sample in a day.
Yeah.
Then they took us to the laser booth and was letting us laser stuff.
What were you lasering?
I lasered my laptop.
Yeah.
The Jordan 20, that Jordan with the like ankle strap.
Yeah, with all the icons on it.
Yeah, yeah.
I lasered my whole laptop with that graphic that was on that strap. Mm.
Were you tempted to do like any of like your haircut designs lasered?
Well, they had programmed a lot of this stuff in the laser. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you just put it in the
You don't just
booth.
Get to hold a laser and like...
Yeah. I mean, but they probably could do that now. You know, it's probably handheld now because that was like, you know, before the Air Yeezy 1.
Yeah.
And during that trip, did that air trainer come out of it?
Yes.
How did that happen? And like, what's the story about those shoes? It's like, I feel like all of us have seen those on like different tumblers throughout our career.
Yeah. So we're in the booth and they're taking us, you know, they're showing us everything. Mm-hmm. And it's just like, holy shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, and then like a couple guys come over and they're like, "You skate, right?" And I was like, "Yeah." And they're like, "Come over here." So he took me over to like the SB area.
Mm-hmm.
And then they gave me like this like pair of tan and black Dunks. That wasn't really, you know, some sample that never came out, but it was like kind of regular. Cause they were just like, "What you think about these?"
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
"What you think about these? What you think about these?" Right. And then they pulled out those trainers and it was, I you know,
Nike SB Air Train
and
too.
It was like, bing.
You know
what I'm saying? And so they were like, "You like these?" And I was like, "Yeah." And so they let me keep the Dunks and they let me keep the trainers. So when we left, I took that picture when I'm like holding them up. And then I posted that. And then I just see, like, a couple months later, they're like, "Yeah, Ferrari Murakami." And I'm like, "What?"
Did they call that shoe the Ferrari Murakami without you knowing it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Nike SB did it internally. Yeah.
Based on your blog?
Yeah. But you know they can't put that out right, with that name. So
were you hyped or were you like, what?
Oh yeah, I was super hyped. Okay. Cause then it was about having the rarest thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This now it's like everybody wants everyone to know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
I come from the school of you ain't up on that.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You let me put you on to something that you don't know about.
You've never heard of this before.
And that's like with the barber thing. It's like you coming to me for style. Like I got all the fashion magazines. I got all the party pluggers. I know all the new restaurants is coming. It's like I'm putting you on to the city. I'm like a concierge to the city.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That was actually one of the best compliments I feel like I've ever got in my life was I was doing, Don C was doing a Converse party in New York. And they were at the Mercer Hotel and we were like sitting in a private room talking to him. And he's like, yeah, I've seen you before. He's like, every time I go to get my hair cut from Ibn Jasper, he puts on Full Size Run and we watch it together.
Because Full Size Run is like barbershop conversation.
Yeah. I thought you were going to say that Don C complimented your haircut.
Yeah, No.
I thought Don was going to Ivan saying, give me the Matt Welty first.
You were talking about like the concierge.
Similar.
The concierge. You're talking about the concierge of culture and like the magazines and all that sort of stuff. Yeah. And when he told me that, I was like,
that's a big compliment coming from these two.
Yeah.
Definitely. The haircuts, like, how did it come about with Kanye just growing up with him, essentially? Was it a John Monopoly thing or
John
what?
Monopoly. We're okay. All, John Monopoly is responsible for everything.
Got it.
Everything pertaining to like hip hop in Chicago is John Monopoly.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? So he was the first hip hop promoter when he was in high school. Cause again, in the 80s and early 90s, Chicago was house music and R. Kelly.
Okay.
Right? Like you was getting dissed for liking hip hop.
Really?
Cause you was broke. Like, yeah. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. The only rappers that they liked was NWA Ghetto Boys. You had to be, you know, cause we a gang city.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like, oh, I like NWA, I like Ghetto Boys. They rap about being a gangster and being a hustler. Then when Biggie came out, Jay-Z came out, that was when the hustlers from Chicago was like, oh, okay, I kind of like this rap stuff.
Mm.
Because it's like getting girls and getting money.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? If you ain't getting girls and ain't getting money, you ain't doing nothing. So even when I was skating, when I moved back, like my mom got married when I was like 8 and then got divorced. Mm-hmm. So when she got married, we moved out to the suburbs. My stepdad worked for IBM. Mm-hmm. So we was living good. Mm-hmm. I started skiing, had snowmobiles, ATVs, skateboarding, all that type of stuff, right?
You had the personal computer?
Yep. My Uncle Russell had an Apple, had a computer room. Had equestrian class, all that type of stuff.
You ride horses?
I could. I used to be a caddy, and you know, I had a good little childhood for a few years. Then we moved back to the hood, and then that's when I was still skating, but I was like skating in the hood, and I was like, "Why are you doing that white boy stuff? What you doing?" Right? Then I ollie, and then it'd be like, "Oh my god!
Yeah.
Oh my god! What did he do?" Right. So that was one of the things I was like, oh, okay, it's really about having like exceptional ability. Mm-hmm. Like if you can do something that people never thought of, mm-hmm. or something like that, then no matter what was going on, you could like change the perspective of something.
Do you remember like the first haircut you gave Kanye? What he asked for? If it was like a simple thing or?
It was just probably like a regular, like either a Caesar or like a fro taper, because I think the fros and tapers and stuff was going on back then. But he told me once, he was like, Manop was his first manager,
mm-hmm.
right? Ye had did, so we were all hearing about this child prodigy named Kanye. He's in high school, he's 16. Mm-hmm. He just did 8 beats on Gravity's album.
Okay.
He got like $15,000. He's got a gold chain with the anchor in high school,
mm-hmm.
right? He's wearing polo in high school, mm-hmm. right? So we're all hearing about this. He lives out in Tinley Park in the suburbs, right? So So Monop's like, yeah, I'm managing them. And I was like, oh, dope. And so I'm like cutting them. I'm cutting Monop, cutting Don. No, I think Don's got long hair at this time. So I cut Don's hair off the first time. Right? So one time he comes back, he tells me, he's like, yo, so Kanye was asking me, he's like, man, who is giving you these perfect haircuts? And he's like, oh, it's my boy Ivan. Yeah. And I had just bought like some production equipment and stuff. So I was like, yo, Manop, you got to teach me how to make beats. Right? Bought an ASR-10. And that's what Ye uses, RZA uses, right? Yeah. So Manop had one, and he was like, yo, I'm teaching people how to do it, right? So I was like, go over there. And he's telling me like, yeah, Kanye was like, man, if you cut his hair, he'll teach you how to make beats. I was like,
damn. That was the payment.
Let's go. Here we go. Yeah. Let's go. So I started going out there, and if you ever seen Ye make beats, like actually make the beat, it's like the most amazing thing, because he doesn't look at the keyboard. He knows how to count all of the commands, so he's just looking around and hands is moving fast, and you're like, what is he doing?
Yeah, crazy.
Do you remember the first beat you watched him make?
No, I remember the first beat I made. First beat I made, I played like this bass sound real high, and then the GZA album came out, and I was like, "They're playing, RZA's playing the beat, the note the same way."
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, "It's a sign. I was meant to do this."
In tune.
We had Christopher Bevins on like a few weeks ago, and he was talking about like early on, you know, like the Kanye 180s, and it's like the same era as, you know, like the S dot shoes and all of that. Do you remember when like those shoes started to kind of happen, like way before Air Yeezy? Were you kind of like excited, like we're gonna get our foot in the like the footwear industry?
Yeah, the S dot Carter.
Yeah,
like that was like the shit, because it was a Gucci.
Yeah,
and it was like, yo, Jay has the best taste. Like, he gets a Reebok deal, and he recreates the Gucci tennis.
And it was kind of like a skate shoe looking model too at the same time, you know.
It was like, you know, that Pete Sampras
shoe. Yeah. The Oscillate.
Yeah. It was like that. But that was it. Then Hove gave Ye the opportunity to do his own version.
He did the little bear, the dropout bear. Yeah.
And I think that's when we had like mascot.
Yeah,
the mascot trainer. Line.
So, yeah, I mean, we looked at Hove, like Iceberg, and you know what I'm saying? It was just like all that type of stuff. 4.6.
Is that mascot shoe? Because I think you mentioned one time on Instagram how there was a David Beckham Adidas sneaker that you felt was derivative of what Kanye had designed for Reebok, where it was.
It wasn't derivative. They took the upper and they gave it to David Beckham.
It was the same exact shoe. As what had originated in the Kanye mascot trainer.
All right, so you remember when Ye was like Louis Vuitton Don, when he was just producing.
Yeah.
Right? So it was a brown Louis sneaker that had like, it was like the Puma sole, brown suede Louis sneaker with the tan on the side. He took that and the Air Max 90, put it together, and did it for a Reebok. So that was gonna be his first shoe. And I know this, because I had the illustrator file, and Kanye gave us the assignment. Each one of you got to do 50 colorways.
50?
Yeah.
Wow. Who was it? Who did? Because
that's
assign?
How we, you know, we open source.
Yeah.
Best idea wins.
Okay.
Like, who do you assign? You? Who else?
Me, Don. I think Virgil was around. I think he had just came over.
Okay.
Oh, another person. So Jay Boogie. Jay Boogie is the source of it all, because like Jay Boogie was doing like Biggie's Leather Goose for the Brat video. You know what I'm saying? Like Jay Boogie was making the clothes for that. My cousin Alpha is named Alpha. Alpha did Resurrection video, Common's Leather Goose. My cousin did that. So and he worked for Jay Boogie. Then Virgil was Jay Boogie's intern. And he was like, yo, I just used to like leave my work on the table because I knew John was going to come into the office. And so that's how John found Virgil, being an intern for Jay Boogie, and then brought him in as a graphic designer for Ye.
So he was tasking you guys 50. But
how crazy was that? Because that just feels like if you were to tell me, like, come up with 50 colorways, I'd be like, man, like, you're sitting there forever, like, trying to...
Nah, man, it was like, ooh, like, Birdman hand rub, yeah, like, yeah. Like, let's go.
It's like the thought you always had, like,
because we've always been thinking, yeah. You know, yeah. we grew up on Jordan, mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, you know, like, oh, this is our time to, like, live the Jordan experience. Yeah, yeah.
Because there's, you know, there's always that story of, like, Kanye talking about, like, when he was growing up, he used to, like, draw Air Jordans in in his notebook in school. Did you kind of have that same sort of thing going on when you were growing up?
Yes and no. So another person, very important, Reggie No Jolly.
Of course.
Reg and I, right? So all of the party pluggers... You've seen how all that cartoon characters with the Louis Vuitton stuff, right?
Dem Dare.
So the Dem Dare parties in high school, he would draw the pluggers, and it's like he's drawing, you know, the people with polo, and it's like it looks exactly like how it looks on the rack.
Mm. Yeah,
mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, and it's all with a Sharpie and everything, and so it was more like Kanye was like sketching sneakers, and I was like doing graffiti. So it was like you had to have a tag, you had to have your letters right, and if you could do characters, you know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? And Reg could do it all and could break dance super good.
So, but then I guess I imagine when you guys kind of sat down like creatively, like you like really like interlocked or whatever, given mm-hmm. that you both kind of had those minds
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, but you know, Ye was the star. Like,
yeah.
We knew that from like day one, you know what I'm saying? And it was like, because we didn't know anybody in Chicago with, like, a record deal. Like, the only person that had a record deal was Chaka Khan and R. Kelly. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And Twista.
Yeah.
Mm. And Tongue Twister. You know what I'm saying? So it was just, like, we got to get somebody from the South Side, like, to get a record deal. Like, I have found Bump J.
Okay.
Then I was working with Ye. And then you had Cap One. And Cap One is, you know, he's with 2 Chainz, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? So we just had, like, you know, it was just this little network of people. And then, you know, it was all, everybody's coming, want to perform at Monop's parties. And, you know, we're just trying to, like, have somebody. But we just knew, like, oh, no, Ye is going to make it. Like, he's going to be the one.
There was no doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah. I want to take it back to Reebok for a sec, just because I want to get the history of this correct. Because nobody's ever really talked about this. What happened that the Reebok shoe never came out?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Yeah.
It's funny. Me and Virgil saw that shoe at an Adidas party in Soho.
The David Beckham one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we were with Wex. And I went and got the shoe off. I'm like, Wex?
Yeah. There was a combo?
I'm like, I designed 50 colorways of this.
He was like, what?
He was like, I'm like, nah, fam.
I know there was like, because there was like a debate when that had come out, right? And I remember talking to people in the industry at the time, and they had claimed that it was James Bond from Undefeated who designed the David Beckham stuff. So they're like, oh, there's no way that Kanye could have designed it.
No, but
it was,
I know.
It was James Bond.
The
Adidas the Cads acquired recently Reebok.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, I'm just saying that's what
Adidas
had happened.
Adidas acquired Reebok. No, but this person probably had the idea to take this upper and put it on a ZX sole. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? That's a design decision.
Back in those days, when did you have the idea, like, I want to do my own shoes? Because, you know, you've done sneakers since then. When were you at the level where you felt like you could have that conversation of, I should be designing shoes?
Probably when Ye texted me in the morning and was like, hey, did you see the prices for the Louis Vuitton shoes?
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, nah. And he's like, oh, look. And I was like, oh, shit, you named this after me?
Mm.
Wow.
And then that was the first
Jasper, yeah.
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 Time that when it could pertain to me. Because it was always like helping him, like whatever right. we could do to help him get it. And it was like, and then the way he did that, like Nike played him, and then he went and did Louis and had a collection and royalties.
That Louis moment was amazing.
And then especially like how it is now, because even that Air Force One, that's not a Nike.
Mm-hmm.
That's a Louis Vuitton sneaker. That's Louis Vuitton telling Nike, no, you ain't on the level. Send us everything, because you can't make a product with an LV on it.
Yeah. In terms of the actual production.
The most recent one.
The recent one is Virgil's.
Yeah. And the first time that happened was when Ye went from Nike to Louis. Like, oh, I can't get a royalty?
Mm.
I'll watch this.
and then go and get a royalty with the Louis Vuitton collection.
Yeah, because that was with Marc Jacobs at the at the time. Which was crazier to you, like the first Nike Air Yeezy or seeing the Kanye Louis Vuitton stuff?
The craziest was the Louis. That was nuts. Like we went to, I remember we went to this Hong Kong Louis Vuitton party because they were like invited us out. Mm-hmm. As, you know, like, yeah, it's coming out next season. Yeah. So, you know, then we just got to see like how Louis does it. You know what I'm saying? Like we saw how Nike did it, but then it was like, now we get to see how like the top of the game does it. And so we're all out there. And I remember Don at the party talking to like the vice president. And he's like, man, like $1,200 retail? You know what I'm saying? Like, word? Like, because this like $300 is like a lot.
Yeah,
some especially, sneakers, right?
You know, 13 years ago.
You know what I'm saying? And I just remember, I think his name was Pietro. He was like, Don C, do not worry. This is Louis Vuitton. It will be sold out in 2 weeks. And he was right.
Yeah.
Pietro knew.
Because he was like, no, it's a Louis Vuitton customer. He was saying stuff like, you can't come in Louis with $200 and leave with anything.
Yeah.
Like, we set, like, we, like.
There's a bar.
Yeah.
It goes back to the aspirational thing you're talking about, where, like, you have to get to this level. We're not going to come down to
it's
your
level.
It's
just funny, though, because it's such, like, a different era, you know, where it's like, if a Kanye Louis Vuitton shoe drops now, the way that like sneaker releases are all built out on the internet, that shoe's like gone before it like even releases, you know. But like, because we had conceded on Full Size Run, and he was talking about he went to like the Ball Harbor like Louis Vuitton store like, you know, a few weeks after, and he like somehow convinced the manager to sell him one of the shoes like a few weeks after it had dropped. But I can't even like fathom that happening nowadays.
Yeah,
different time.
Like, you know what you have to do to be able to get one of them Air Forces?
You have to, well, they had said that originally it was like you had to spend like close to like over $1 million in the store. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like that's the type of customer base they have.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like people need, like it's levels to everything.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
When the Louis shoe came out with your name on it, obviously you had a pair, but were you trying to get a bunch of pairs, you know, to stash away or something?
My whole thing, gratitude is the attitude.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I don't have like a sense of entitlement with
any. But your name's on it.
I don't own Louis Vuitton. My name ain't Louis Vuitton. Like I'm very like, because I'm a, you know, I started my business when I was like 14. Like I understand business.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like I don't have a sense of entitlement like that. Like, I'm not delusional like that. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's a privilege, and I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm like, okay, how can I, you know, because, like, Ye did that shoe. It's basically, like, his version of an airwalk.
Really?
Right? Well, it kind of looks, yeah, you could see it, the original, like, you Tony Hawk
like
style.
That big strap and everything. Like, it's like an airwalk, right? So that's, he's like, oh, it's kind of like an 80s skate shoe, so I'm going to name it after Ivan. You know what I'm saying? And the Don is a Jordan 4.
With the collar on the back.
In the wings.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Like the Mr. Hudson's, like the boat
it's
shoe.
It's a boat shoe. Yeah. And it's like, oh, my British homie. Like, my British classic homie. You know what I'm saying?
that's sometimes you don't think of it like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What's one thing about the Nike Air Yeezy moment that you can remember that is like, just sticks out amongst how crazy it was? I think for all of us, we remember that as like something that you remember exactly where you were, where they got announced and released. But like, what do you remember from that first batch of Nike Air Yeezys?
Just the whole like process. Cause even like that time we were talking about, we're in the kitchen, they were, we got this. So like, it was just all these like different examples of ideas and everything. So like, then they came up with the like Y,
the print
monogram print thing, and the neoprene on the blink colorway, and the glow in the dark. It was just.
Were you guys just in the kitchen, just like kids in the candy
store
for real?
Yeah, but Ye was also like very diligent in, you know, making choices. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, because when you got a lot of options, it's very hard to make to be decisive.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like 50 colorways each on the Reebok joint. It's like, yeah.
I'm imagining you didn't make 50 colors each of the Air Yeezy ones.
No, we didn't get that assignment.
But there were a lot of colorways floating around. Yeah. I remember GLC that back in the day had a bunch of random colorways that never came out.
Tinker's got his own colorway.
Yeah, the white and blue with the strap. That all glow sample.
We had talked to Tiffany Beers. She talked about how there was like all these like random ones that just like pop up.
Yeah, the Death Star one with the circle on the midsole.
Oh, you know, Ye wants to see.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I'll make it.
Right.
Yeah.
We don't need to release
it. I don't want to see a mock-up of it.
Mm-hmm. You know, even with, like, the Air Yeezy 2, there was, like, that
purple one?
That PJ Tucker.
There's all those random.
I mean, I guess you could just ask PJ Tucker. He's probably got, like,
everything. Yeah, got all of them.
I think he had the shoes, right?
And yeah, he has that cheetah Kobe purple colorway of the Yeezy 2.
I think he got the 180s.
Oh, the Nike Air 180?
Mm. I think he got them, too.
Yeah, wow.
That's a tough one in his size, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, Ye made them, but Ye got them to sample everything in a 12.
Okay.
Because everything's usually sampled in a 9.
Yeah.
Mm. So that was like one of the things, like, oh man, he got them to sample it in a different size.
Yeah.
It was just so, you know, dude, he made a lot of breakthroughs.
You guys were such a confident crew, but how, like, seeing him design gave you kind of like just a leg up in designing your own stuff, especially with footwear.
He took kind of a producer's approach. Mm-hmm. Like the way he works in the studio is the approach that he took as a designer, because he didn't necessarily know how to use the design software, right? So like that's why Virgil, he used to say, Virgil is my hands. Like I think it, and then Virgil can keep up with the way I think and do it in Photoshop, right? And so we got to see like the mood board bouncing and it, but he could sketch and stuff like that. That was one of the things when we did the graduation album, and having Tekashi do the packaging and everything. So we would go to Kaikai Kiki every morning, because we lived in Tokyo for like a month during that. And Tekashi said one day, cause like Tekashi would just be like 50 different album covers, like, and he would have them like, they would be like this big and it would be all over the studio. Mm-hmm. So we'd like walk in the room and you're just like looking at all of this different stuff, right? And Ye would kind of just walk around and draw different elements from the ones that he liked and he would put it in one sketch. And Tekashi was like, oh, I like, he was like, I speak Japanese, he speaks English, we have a language barrier, but we both speak art, right? Mm-hmm. So Ye would take that production approach in music into the design studio, which translated very well, right? Because you've got the soul guy that's doing all of the technical stuff. You know, it's different people. And so he's like used to working with the string player and the keyboard player,
right?
You know what I'm saying? So it's like the same thing, or it's a similar thing. And so we looked at that. When Virgil came on, and this other dude named Tony that used to work for Pastel, that was the first time I had ever seen like someone design a shoe in Photoshop, and then it looked real. Mm. Like I'm like, oh, that's not a real shoe. It's like, no, he made this in Photoshop.
Yeah, because sometimes you see the CADs and stuff, and you're like, this doesn't look that cool. It's just a flat.
And then I saw him do it. It was like he got the, like, okay, I want to make something like an Air Force One, like the silhouette of an Air Force One. Mm. So he like Google Air Force One.
This is Tony or Virgil?
Tony.
Yeah.
He get the picture and then be like, okay, I want it like black ostrich on the toe. And then he like Google ostrich material. He get that picture, put it on a layer over the panel, and then like, you know,
fill
like,
out the panel like, with the layer.
Lasso it and, you know, do everything.
Magnetic lasso.
Yeah, and do all of that and then like put the shadow on it. And I'm like,
what is going on here?
I just remember looking at the screen like, I gotta learn how to do that.
Yeah.
Because my whole thing is like, oh, the trick is to get the image in your head on the screen so you don't have to explain anything. Because that's what I'm used to seeing Ye do, is explain, and it's almost there.
Right. Like, I'd rather show you than tell you.
Exactly.
Right?
And then I was like, oh, Tony knows how to like
manifest.
Boom. Yeah. You know? And then Virgil just, you know, he just could learn. He knew how to do everything on a computer, like pop willies on your laptop.
when you first saw like the 10 from Virgil, like what was your reaction to that? Because it was like, it came at an interesting time too, because it was like Kanye had left Nike and he's like at Adidas doing his thing, and then Virgil's like his right hand man, but now he's at Nike kind of like satisfying that role, that like, or the void that Kanye left at the to some extent, you know what I mean? Or just as far as like, these is like the most hype or like exciting things that the brands are creating at the time. Like, do you remember like when that all first happened?
Yeah, that's when I was like, oh, Nike says that fashion is not a bad word anymore, because fashion used to be a bad word,
right,
on the Nike campus, right? That was why they wouldn't give Kanye a royalty, like, you aren't an athlete, so no, right? And so we was aggy about that, like, we ain't respect that, especially with Ye performing in the same arenas that they play
as the athletes.
You know what I'm saying? Yep. Like, selling by itself.
Yep, filling them.
2.5 hours, same length as the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So he's a performance athlete. So for them to play him like that was bogus. So when they did it with Virgil, I mean, Virgil killed that shit.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? It was like in that Jordan 1, it was like vintage skateboarding and like Bauhaus.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it was just, that shit was just ill. And then the blazer, though, was like, that's my favorite.
You a big blazer guy?
No, Virgil's blazer.
Yeah.
Like the blazer and the Jordan 1. But the blazer, because I'm a skater, so mm-hmm. I'm always partial to a vulcanized mm-hmm. shoe. And then the way he did the vulc check that went over the sole and everything, where I'm like, oh, he's like making the check part of the like durability as a skate shoe.
I think he had given a pair to Costin too when they came out, which was like so cool to
see.
But
the funniest thing about that whole thing was Costin teaching him how to do a tray flip at the thing. And I hit Costin, I was like, man, bro, thank you, man. I've been trying to teach this dude this for like 5 years.
You guys are doing that backstage Watch the Throne, right?
Yeah.
He had the clean tray flip.
Like, Virgil, put your back foot on, fam. Like, you almost got it.
The vulcanized thing was important for you on your Converse project too. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. All right, so we were at the 2020 All-Star Game. Mm-hmm. Me and Don did like a little panel for them. Mm-hmm. And they were like, okay, next one for you is the one star. I was like, you know I'm going to go vulcanize crazy, right? Because I had already did Stratica and figured out how to, like, do my own version of a vulcanized shoe, where I just completely changed the shape of the bumpers, right? Because I was watching, like, YouTube videos in shoe factories of how they do vulcanized shoes.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, they, like, got a pair of scissors and they're cutting.
Yeah.
They're cutting a shape with some scissors. I'm a barber.
Yeah.
Okay.
Here we go.
You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, oh, okay, I'll like show you how to cut some shapes with some scissors. You know what I'm saying? So I was like, okay, I'm gonna apply that to what I do, and it's also like a vision streetwear thing too.
Yeah.
Like how it's like the extra rubber patches mm-hmm. for extra durability and stuff like that. So it's the process of making a vulcanized shoe, then the history of Converse. So Marquise Converse started that brand in 1908. Mm. It is the sports shoe brand with the most history, right? And Converse was a rubber company. Like, they used to make like raincoats. They was like Macintosh,
mm-hmm.
right? They used to make raincoats and boots and stuff like that. They were part of the companies that invented vulcanized rubber. Right. Mm-hmm. So like without Converse, we wouldn't even have like tires wouldn't even be what they were for what Converse was doing. So I wanted to get into that. And then I like did the research on like when the One Star came out in the 60s.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was doing Stratica, it was like based on European rally cars from the 80s. Since Converse is an American company, I was like, what is a American supercar in the 60s? A Corvette.
Mm.
So I just based my One Star design on a Corvette. So this shoe is based on the C2 Corvette. It's like 1963 C2 Corvette Grand Sport chassis number 5. It's worth $8 million. Wow. There's only 5 of these cars in the world. Zora Duntoff, who is the man behind the Corvette. That's why you got like Z everything for Zora. So he was in Chevy and he was like making the race versions of everything, right? So he took the Corvette, and then he made like these 5 race cars and had like these little racing teams. But then it was like accidents happening, so Chevy was like, no more racing. So that's why these 5 race cars or these Corvettes are like worth so much money. So I like looked at the hood of the car and had the vents, and so that's like the T-toe thing, like all of this right here on the vents. But it's also like a DC Lynx.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm taking old school skate shoes and the Plaza era, like what you were talking about, the Stevie Williams, like when skateboarding left Southern California and went to the East Coast and got infused with hip hop.
Yeah.
Right? So that's the Plaza era. So it was like I took that DC hip hop street era of skateboarding and then put it on the old school Volkswagen.
You mentioned the race cars. Are you an F1 guy at all?
A little bit.
Have you seen the Netflix series?
Yeah. I watch it occasionally.
I'm big on the F1 thing, so I'm trying to like increase the public perception of me like, as a huge F1 fan.
F1, like I'll watch old Gordon Murray documentaries, like Parmalat, like when everything was different and they were.
So
like
you went too deep for me already.
And they're like experimenting and like each race team's car is different.
Yeah.
Because now it's just, everything's just too like homogenized.
Are we going to any upcoming races? I'm trying to get some tickets.
I wanted to go in Miami.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, I wish I would have known because we released it like the same
time. Right, it's like a racing thing.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, we'll be at Silverstone. That's the plan. So if anybody wants to send me some tickets. Well, sorry, that was an important TSA for me.
Right, got the F1. okay. Border out of the way.
One of my homegirls was in Miami, and she was like going to everybody's garage. Like, look.
You know?
Yeah.
Looked like a good time.
Put you on the grid with the mic?
Come on, something, man.
Ibn, I want to get your take on the Jordan 4 SB.
Okay.
How do you feel about that? Have you ever skated in Jordan 4s? You're going to wear test them if they want? Mm-hmm. What is your thoughts on that? Like, we saw Costin and like the Black Cats. There was like, what are they?
No, that's supposed to be a sample.
That's the sample.
That's not a Black Cat.
Yeah,
it's a sample.
That's an SB sample because that's suede. And then word through the grapevine is that they re-engineered the toe box.
Okay.
To make it more skate ready, but that shoe is already like, that's my favorite Jordan besides a one.
This is the 4.
The 4?
To skate in.
Okay.
Because the Jordan 4 is basically like a DC.
Kind of mid with the air bubble.
And I've skated in 2 pairs. I got that one clip when we're in Oslo, when we're skating. I'm skating in the white cement 4s. And then I did this Ill Roots thing. I think it's on Complex.
Okay.
I did it. It was like a little 1-minute thing, and I'm skating in a Fear 4.
So 4 is good.
The
skate.
Fear 4 is probably like my favorite skate 4.
I'm actually glad you're saying
this. We were just talking about the Fear
4. Just last week you were saying how bad the Fear 4s were.
I didn't say.
The Fear 4 is good. It's the different shades, black, gray, and white.
And it's the Fear 4 is like my design philosophy, right? So I like the heavier color in the heel and the lighter color in the toe.
It's like a gray.
I don't like when it's like white heel and black toe. It's like.
Off balance.
Yeah, I think all the weight should be in the heel of a shoe.
Didn't you say you didn't like the Fear 4?
I was talking about that era. I said it was premium Pete, like era that's of true. Jordan retro.
That's true. Yeah. That's why I skated in them though, because I'm like, oh, I'll get this form skate in it. Because yeah. I like getting like fly shoes and fucking them up.
It's just it's just interesting because you know there's always like, for like you know some people, if like you're not like super into skating, it's like you don't remember these like. Moments of like you know like Vinny Ponti skating in like Air Jordan 11s or you know
Marcus
even like,
McBride and sevens
just these random
sevens is a really good skate shoe
really
yeah. So give us some knowledge. People may not know that these Jordans are good skate shoes or even other models.
So skate shoes is all about board feel, right? It's a balance of board feel and cushioning and protection. Right, so that's why the SB Dunk has a thick tongue, because you flipping the board, the board might come primo, land on the top of your foot.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You need the protection, right? But you're also like jumping downstairs, so you need like
the cushion.
Padding, mm-hmm. you know, cushioning, you know, for the bottoms of your feet because you jumping off stuff all the time. But you also need it to be thin enough so that when you can flick with the right amount of pressure and then you can catch because you have to, you flick and you catch in the air. So it's everything is like very delicate, you know what I'm saying, but and precise. And you got to remember like a skateboard trick only is like a second and a half, 2 seconds. Like I learned that from editing stuff. Like,
it's a small window.
Yeah, but when you're doing it, it seems like 10 seconds. Like when you're doing a kickflip down some stairs, it's like, it seems like forever.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But it's really like super fast, like in actuality. So you got to do all of this stuff in like milliseconds. So it's like this perfect balance. That's why I like a Volk shoe, but I need to have like a lot of padding, like a lot of cushioning in it.
I guess the Jordan 7, then you have like a lot of height on it, kind of, right?
But it's thin, the sole's thin. You know, like the toe doesn't have a lot of layers on it. Like a Jordan 3 is not good for skating.
Why?
Because you got elephant skin, then a layer of leather, then another layer of leather.
You don't have that board feel in it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, okay. And that sole is stiff, but the 4 is like a little thinner and more flexible, and then it's got that extra rubber on the side.
What did you think when you saw Rocky do the Under Armour
Osiris shoe? Yeah. I thought it was dope. I love Rocky. But it's bogus that Dave Mayhew acted like he designed it and he didn't.
Yeah, I know there was that whole like, you know, like dispute
online
where there was like an actual designer and it really wasn't even like his shoe to begin with, and it kind of like got hodgepodge at the last
minute.
But I
like how they did it. I like the update of like the Under Armour update of how they did that. And it's like everybody, like, it's funny to me how like the skate world now is like, this is our thing. And it's like, fam, when we was doing this, we wanted everybody to think it was cool.
Like, you worked hard for it to get to this level.
We wanted this.
Yeah.
And man, why are they doing that? Why is Louis Vuitton making skate shoes? Because the guy that making all the stuff for Louis Vuitton skated.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, when he did the Lucian, like when Virgil did the Lucian shoe, that was just like, it felt like crazy.
It's like, yo, he skate. He knows how to do a kickflip. Like, what are you talking about? And everybody knows what skateboarding is. Everybody knows who Tony Hawk is. You know what I'm saying?
Now, it's not your secret club anymore.
This is not something over in the corner anymore, right? Mm. So all that like being a little shithead thing that they're on, like you're actually not, because if you're a skater, you're supposed to be being progressive, right? And that's not progressive.
I guess like peak era for you a bit is like, you know, when Pharrell does like the ice cream skate team.
Absolutely.
And even at the time that was like controversial, you know, like Plain Gravy did that t-shirt, Pharrell can't skate, and that was like people like taking shots. All
right, so this was the dynamics with that. So I always tell people, I was like, I have a coin in my pocket. Mm. Pharrell's on one side of the coin and Stevie's on the other side, right?
Yeah.
So that's really what that whole thing was, because they both had their deals at Reebok.
Yeah.
Right? And it was like, and so that's what Stevie did an interview, and he was like, man, I was like jealous. He was like, but now I'm like, man, I was bogus. You know, like we was really doing the same thing, because it was basically like making skating cool for black people. Yeah. Like Pharrell made skateboarding cool to drug dealers, right? And then Stevie showed the streets that you could get money being a pro skater, like a professional athlete.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And both of them, I mean, Pharrell wasn't trying to like take anything away from Stevie, but Stevie felt like, you know, like I'm the real thing.
Yeah, he was like the real, like it was like different levels of it where Stevie's
and
like
Stevie
the real
was
pro
like
skater.
The best skater,
yeah,
too. You know what I'm saying? And then he was dealing with all of the, you know, he was getting a little blackballed or whatever, and then he got on chocolate, and then it was just over with.
Mm-hmm.
Stevie had to go through a lot, so like I understand like Stevie's chip, you know what I'm saying? But it's, you know, it's like one of them things where like the the dynamics of the situation kind of pits you against somebody that you're not really against.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Like, you didn't want to be in that position. Like, nobody wants to be in that position. It's just, like, the optics of it.
Yeah, but it's like they're both kind of pushing for the same thing. Mm-hmm. And then the public is like, I like the way he's doing it. Yeah. I like, you know, and then, you know, most of the public is, you know, most of the public knows about Pharrell, so.
It was funny, too, at the time, because, you know, it's like, there's, like, Terry Kennedy on, you know, Ice Cream, and then, like, Stevie had a beef with Terry, like, before that, and it was just, like, it just seems like it was just, like, a whole shitstorm of stuff. You know?
It's, you know, but, hey, man, it is what it is, man.
Do you have any stories from Evergreen Plaza Mall on, like, Jordan release day that you can remember?
Oh, yeah.
You and the crew just shopping early 2000s, what do you remember?
Yeah, you know, you skipping school, you know, like, it's crazy on the weekends, mm-hmm. you know, and it's like the Foot Locker dudes is, like, up in there hustling, like, yeah. you know what I'm yeah. saying? Like, it's just, like, a different era. Like, I remember I was telling somebody the other day, I was, like, I remember going to my freshman orientation in 1988, and I'm, like, in high school, and dudes is walking around with the white fours with the wings out, and I'm, mm-hmm. like,
yeah,
okay. And then playoffs, like, the first ring, I'm like, outside the school, playoffs come, I'm looking at the bus, all the kids getting off the CTA bus, all black sixes. It's just like,
wow.
All black sixes.
Almost like a uniform.
Just everybody black sixes, black six, black six. You know, to this day, like, black six is my favorite, like, black sneaker.
You and Steven Victor.
Yeah, it's the best black sneaker.
But those days, huh?
Yeah. And it's like excellence because, you know, it's like, again, Jordan's like elephant skin, yeah. iguana, yeah. like it's, you know, it's like pimping, you know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? It's like the same
spoilers thing. On the back.
Yeah, you yeah. know what I'm saying? Like, oh, the 14 is a Ferrari.
Yeah.
You yeah. know what I'm saying?
Patent like, leather.
Yeah, the patent leather stuff. 11, like tuxedo basketball shoe, you yeah. know what I'm saying? It's just like everything's next level. And Tinker just, you know what I'm saying? He just took it that way. And so that was like Virgil's thing too, like,
yeah.
oh, I started as an architect too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, because the air bubble came from the Pompey deal.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying?
Exposed.
Do you ever talk to Stephen Smith about sneakers? Do you have, like, a friendship yeah. with him? What's
yeah.
that like?
Yeah, he be complimenting me. On, oh, I love the rap. I love how you rap. You know, Stephen's, like, the best dude ever. Like,
because he'll get in the comments and say, you know, yeah. like, you know? But that's
he's active.
But, like, yeah. in the Yeezy office and all that, it's like, oh, come check this out.
Yeah.
Dope. So, like, he yeah. was there, too.
Do you guys go hiking together?
Salehi did a 350, an injection molded 350.
Really?
Okay.
I probably shouldn't have said that.
Cat's out the bag.
Another real quick thing I want to talk about. When did you decide to get the Bape barber cape, though?
Oh, I didn't decide that.
What happened with that?
We did that show. It was a festival in okay. Japan.
Mm-hmm.
Nerd was performing. We were performing. I think it was Glow in the Dark because Lupe was there. Mm. We were there. Pharrell was there. Nerd was there. We got there. Lupe walks me to his dressing room and he's like, I said your government name on a song.
The reason I get fly is yeah. I have a Jasper.
And I was like, play it for me. He's like, no, you're going to have to wait till it comes out. All right. And then I'm like about to cut Yay, and then Nigo walks in the room. He's like, here. And I was like, Nigo, but it's like in a bag. It's like a
small, right?
It's yeah, like a little
you don't know what
you
it,
even
is,
know what it yeah. is,
right? And then he's like, and he gives me two of them. There's the tan Bape camo one, and then like a regular like woodland mm-hmm. Bape camo one, right? So he gives me both of them. He takes one, he unzips it, and I'm like,
damn.
He's like, yeah, it's got sleeves. I was like, from Nigo makes himself. A barber cape with sleeves that zips into a pouch, like a hiking jacket or yeah. something. And it's just like, oh, of course, you know,
of course
General Nigo.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, bro, a lot of that stuff, that's what I'm saying. Gratitude is attitude. Yeah. Like, people be thinking of me.
Love that.
I'm just grateful to be written, my name to be written next to these people in the book of life. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. That's one of my favorite, I guess maybe like a selfish thing, one of my favorite eras is when Kanye did this song with the Teriyaki Boys.
Yeah.
like, do you like remember like being, were you in Japan when all that happened? Yeah. Like, yeah. So remember he's like wearing like the troop jacket like in the video, yeah. And they all had like the bape on.
So like Harajuku, you know, is like the illest. Oh, another thing. So after I cut Ye's hair with the cape, Ye's like, I'm wearing this on stage.
I think I remember that.
And he turned it around and put it on his back. And so it was just kind of like a cape with sleeves.
I think that's on Getty. Yeah. I think that's on Getty Images.
He's like on stage with the barber cape on performing.
Yeah. Batman.
You know what I'm saying? But yes, so graduation album, about half of it was recorded in Bape Sound Studios. Mm. We got Tekashi doing artwork and merch. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, Nigo's like, yeah, whatever you need. You got the studio, but then like Harajuku, the craziest vintage shopping in the world, right? So like that's where all of the troop jackets and all of that. And then that was when Nigo and Pharrell agreed with Kanye to produce Pastel. So that was like that one Pastel hoodie with the full zip with the rays and stuff. Like that was Bape production. So yeah, we was just, you know, eating at Bape Cafe every day and staying at the Park Hyatt in Roppongi.
Wow.
And, you know what I'm saying? Like,
it was just, Curry Up?
Oh, of course.
I ate with him at Curry Up.
What?
Yeah, this was like the last time I saw him.
I ate with him at Curry Up.
I got the human-made pants on right now, but I need to go to Curry Up.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, and there's a, Stephen Victor told us there's one opening in New York, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. I was trying to get, I'm like, Cuddy, you need to get one in L.A.
Yeah.
Like, tell me how to open one in L.A.
Yeah, me, you, and Dennis in Tokyo. Yeah. That's the last time I saw you.
Yeah. I remember seeing Tekashi. He was like, oh, what you doing out here?
Listen, this has been so good. The good thing about this podcast is, like, we get a lot of history, but then we always leave a lot of room on the cutting room floor. Next time you have another collab, you come back.
Okay.
We talk part two, definitely. Yes.
You've seen so much.
Oh, yeah, see, one quick.
Like yeah.
Converse, Ibn Jasper, 1 star, out now if you could find them. Thank you so much. Anything else you could talk about before we go or coming up? Stay tuned.
Oh, I'm got my hair products coming out, Lake Manor Select.
Okay.
You know, since I am a professional hairstylist, you know. But I'm making some really good shampoo that smells really good, works really good for you guys.
Awesome.
You know, it's oud fragrance, so you might not even need cologne.
I got a lot of hair to shampoo, you know, so I need it.
Yeah. And girls going to be like, man, you smell good.
Nothing new for me.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, man. Really appreciate you coming
thank
by.
Thank you, guys.
Finally got to meet.
I know.
Yeah.
I know. We've been waiting.
It's a moment.
I know, Joe, though.
Yep.
That's my guy.
This has been the Complex Sneakers Podcast. We hope everyone has a great weekend. Please like, subscribe. We will see you next week.
Peace.